Baltimore, located on the Patapsco River, is the largest city in Maryland and one of the oldest cities in the United States. Baltimore Town was founded in 1729 and became Baltimore City in 1796. But the history of Baltimore and its surrounding areas dates back even earlier to when John Smith explored the Chesapeake Bay in the early 1600s. Through maps and his early accounts with the Native Americans who first inhabited the region, John Smith spoke of the abundance of trees and marsh that surrounded the area, as well as the different species of fish and wildlife that he came across during his voyage. And although the landscape has changed and the water quality has diminished, one thing has not changed, and that is the people who recognize how significant this water and this land is to all of us.
The Healthy Harbor Initiative is a plan to make the water fishable and swivable by the year 2020. It is also a way to have a community, better environment, and a better place to live for all of us.
The harbor is located at the base of two main watersheds, the Grands Falls watershed and the Jones Falls watershed. A watershed is an area of land where all the water from that area drains into a particular place. In our case, that would be the harbor. And as far as the water quality of a swimmable and fishable harbor is concerned, the focus of this initiative is going to be the Middle Branch and the Northwest Branch areas of the harbor.
The harbor is something we can do something about. The big goal, 2020 is a long time off, but also not very long. So we've got a lot of work to do. We've raised a lot of money, $500,000, to write a plan. And the plan is about this thick, and it says, what are the things we need to do this year and next year, leading all the way up to 2020? And it's important when you put together a plan like this, that the plan be step by step.
The Healthy Harbor Initiative is about more than just a swimmable, fishable harbor. It's about the neighborhoods, the people, the wildlife. Each one affects the other. It's not possible to have a healthy harbor without healthy neighborhoods.
Your environment has a lot to do with your mental health. And I think this initiative is making us feel better and be more conscious. If we could inform people in the communities about their environment, what a good connect that also makes for the harbor. Because the harbor, you can see the outpour of trash that comes from the watershed, you know, as a result. Well, with that education in mind, it did plant a seed in my mind as well as our community. What we learned is that communities really can do more in their environment. Granted, we do have a city and we pay taxes, and we do have expectation how we want our dollars to be used. But we also have people in the community. And if you want your area to look better, we can't always expect people who might be working 2-3 jobs or may have other demands on their time to always come out and sweep the entire block. We're fortunate we can get people to come out and sweep just in front of their houses. But what we found we were able to do through this dedicated fund is to provide a stipend for 2 of our residents, which offers them some part-time work that's helpful. So we're becoming a helpmate to persons in our communities. They're very committed. They do an excellent job.
I feel pretty good about being able to be a part of it, you know, helping keep the community clean. Because this is a nice community, you know. And as long as I stay here, I want to kind of help keep it that way. So I felt that by me helping out here doing this, you know, it makes me feel like I'm a part of this, helping keep it clean.
When you keep your neighborhood clean, it doesn't get in the water, it looks better. You can take a little pride in it, you know. And you know, I take pride when I look at the streets and they look like this, and then at the end, you look back, look all the way down the street, and it looks nice, you know. So you build a little pride when you do a little cleaning. It's changed me. I used to be a litter bug, I have to admit it. And now, you know, I'm conscious about where I throw my trash. I'll hold it till I see a trash can. I seen a guy today when I was coming to work, he was picking up stuff. And I thank them, you know, so it'll get to you after a while if you keep it up.
The reason that the Healthy Harbor Initiative today is important to my students is because of the opportunities that it has opened up for them. My students have been working on projects that contribute to the Healthy Harbor Initiative all year long. We found that when the students initiate a project, it sparks a cycle of inspiration.
The Healthy Harbor Initiative is important to me because me, I love animals. And seeing that all we have to do is stop littering and save them, we could do that.
I love Baltimore City. And to have trash in the Inner Harbor, to me, doesn't make sense. I think cleaning up the trash helps prevent bacteria and pollutants from getting into the Inner Harbor, which cause health problems and the like.
I think this initiative is important because it's all about affecting the individual's behavior change. And if we get more people to appreciate and have a great understanding of the environment, then they have a much better chance of caring for it.
If we don't do this, then if like a tourist comes and sees the harbor, he's gonna give it a bad like overview, a bad report about it. And that it could become a wasteland where everybody would wanna dump their waste because it wouldn't be clean anyway. So, but if we can clean it, then we could get good reports and improve the water so we could swim and fish here instead of going all the way down to Ocean City or up to Jones Falls River to go fishing or swimming.
I did actually contact the Department of the Environment and Baltimore City Health Department with the possibility of doing a swim from Fort McHenry to Key Bridge or from one to the other or back and forth. And the universal opinion was that no, there were too many pollutants. I feel like if I want to be able to swim and have that experience, I need to help, you know, be part of ensuring that the waters are cleaned up for everybody.
The Healthy Harbor Initiative is important to me because all the trash that's in the harbor, it means a lot to people, and people just use it as their personal own trash can. Well, it's not a personal trash can, it's the harbor. Fish live in it too. And if y'all were the fish, y'all wouldn't like the trash in the harbor because we just saw dead fish out there. It's not right.
For many years, the Baltimore Harbor was a major shipping hub for the transport of tobacco and grain. Baltimore became known for shipbuilding, everything from clipper ships in the early 1800s to eventually Liberty ships during World War II. Various industries and factories lined the waterfront of the harbor. Baltimore was thriving with the hustle and bustle of industry and urban development. However, water quality was an unfortunate casualty of this industrial revolution. Through stricter laws and increased public awareness, both public and private, the health of the harbor has made some improvements throughout the years, but there still remains major challenges.
The Waterfront Partnership is the group that hired us to conduct the health assessment or report card for Baltimore Harbor. We took water quality data that was already being measured by Maryland Department of Natural Resources here in the harbor, as well as the bacteria data that's being measured by the Baltimore Waterkeeper and Blue Water Baltimore groups. And so what we did was we took different indicators of health and scored them to say, is it healthy or is it unhealthy? And then you take those indicators and you average them into an overall grade for the harbor. For 2010, the report card showed that the health of the harbor is poor, which I don't think is surprising. It found that dissolved oxygen conditions, chlorophyll A, water clarity is really poor. These types of water quality indicators show us what the water is doing. Bacteria scored poorly in the inner harbor, but not as bad in the middle branch. And bacteria is an indicator for swimmable, so that if you jump in the water, it tells you if you're going to get sick or not. And so that's what the bacteria indicator really shows.
In 1915, Baltimore's sanitary sewer system first opened. This separation of the sewer pipes and the stormwater pipes were considered advanced during that time. Many cities have only one system of drains and pipes where both sewage and stormwater flow. That type of system tends to lead to overflows and other problems. Baltimore's system helps to prevent some of those issues, but much of that system is close to 100 years old. As a result, there are leaks and breaks that have occurred, resulting in some sewage making its way through the harbor, which ultimately means that bacteria makes its way to the harbor. The city and county have started to replace some of the older pipes.
Bacteria doesn't just make its way to the harbor by sewage. Animal waste is another way that bacteria can get into the harbor, caused by runoff.
When it rains, water runs off impervious surfaces like rooftops, sidewalks, and streets, and takes with it animal waste, oils, chemicals, fertilizer, and other pollutants. This polluted water then makes its way into storm drains and streams and eventually into the harbor. But unlike sewage, stormwater is untreated before it makes its way to the harbor.
What people do on the land is really what affects the harbor. One of the major problems with the Inner Harbor is the trash. So trash is a huge issue in any urban environment, and this trash comes flowing down these stormwater drains and gets blown into the water when it's windy, and that creates a very bad environment for fish.
Residents within the Harris Creek watershed know this issue all too well. The 17 neighborhoods from Clifton Park to Canton that make up the Harris Creek watershed have dedicated themselves to the cleanup effort.
We met with all the 17 neighborhoods, and their greatest concern was trash. And they were seeing trash that they had never seen before. It was just a tremendous amount of trash that was piling up in the city.
Can you imagine the 17 neighborhoods, at least half of them, half of the area, we found 100 dumps. Once we cleaned up over 100 of these mini landfills or dumps, we reduced the trash into the Inner Harbor at Harris Creek from 4 tons to less than 1 ton per month.
There are going to be many challenges in cleaning up the harbor, but trash shouldn't be one of them. Taking your time, don't weigh your trash properly, and even recycling is something everyone can do.
Bacteria and trash are major challenges to a fishable, swimmable harbor, but so are nutrients, and sometimes too much of a good thing can be bad. Fish breathe dissolved oxygen. If there is too much algae in the water, then a process called eutrophication will happen.
Eutrophication is a process when a whole lot of nutrients go into the water, and the algae, they love nutrients, so they grow like crazy, and they block off the sunlight for fish and submerged underwater grasses, and then they die. And then when all the nutrients run out, the algae die. So then at the bottom, decomposers such as bacteria come up and they eat the algae and the dead fish, and they use oxygen to eat it. So when there's no more oxygen, they die, and the fish die, and the whole place can become a dead zone, which is a place where there is no oxygen available.
Toxicants in the harbor are also a problem for aquatic life and humans. Although sometimes fish may not immediately die from toxicants, they do absorb various contaminants into their system, which in return can be absorbed into our systems as we eat fish. So even though you may not fish or swim in the harbor, the effects of polluted waterways still reach far beyond the waterfront. The challenges may seem big, but this is possible. Baltimore's initiative to having a swimmable, fishable harbor is not a new idea.
One success story would be in Boston, the Charles River. In 1995, the river was horrible looking. It was just horribly nasty looking. It had broken sewage pipes under it, causing leaks, and it was just nasty. And then they said, hey, let's clean it up. So they designed to have it cleaned up in 10 years, so that would be to 2005. And already by 2005, they had already been having annual swims, and people would be able to fish in the water, and you could swim in there.
I just have swam in different places, and I've learned that there are cities like Baltimore that have an industrial history, and still, you know, have a port history and are. And are urbanized, where enough has been done to make it possible to turn their harbors into swimming venues and athletic event venues. For example, Manhattan which is, now we're talking about the Hudson River, the East River, the Harlem River. Every year for like 30 years now, the Manhattan Island Foundation has sponsored a swim around Manhattan.
The mayor stood at the press conference with me last year, and actually one the year before, and she said, look, no plan is a good plan without a goal, so let's work toward 2020. There's not much we can do this year, as an example, to make the water swimmable. The swimmable part, the fishable part, is going to come in 2015, 16, 17. So what can we do this year? Well, let's break it down. When we think about trash, we need to work neighborhood by neighborhood. And every neighborhood's different. So we have 250 neighborhoods in the city. Some are very urban, like Sharp Leadenhall, right next to Ravens Stadium. And some have a lot more trees and a lot more grass, like Rowan Park and Guilford. So we have to come up with a plan for each of them.
Harris Creek is one of 26 outlets to the Inner Harbor. We figured if we can clean up the trash in one watershed, we could go around the Inner Harbor to the other 26 and do the same project successfully, identify where the large accumulations of trash were, and then to get the Department of Public Works and Housing to work with us in order to clean those areas up as well.
The 2010 report card was kind of the first start of it. The 2011 report card will come out in 2012, and then so on and so forth. The 2011 report card will use the same data from Maryland Department of Natural Resources for water quality. However, in the future, Blue Water Baltimore is collecting lots more water quality data, both in the Inner Harbor and the Middle Branch areas. And so in future report cards, the data will be much bigger and a lot more of it.
Public outreach is an integral part of our program. We only deal with 50 kids, so while those 50 kids may have a real deep understanding of the problem and the solutions, Baltimore City has 500,000 people, and if we want to have a harbor that's cleaned up by the year 2020, we need to spread the word. We've done several PSAs that are on television, and the news has covered our students both in action on the Wetlands Day, our kids have given tours of the ATS, and they've also been on the radio. So we're trying to hit as many different media outlets. Additionally, we have a blog where the kids have been explaining what they've been doing sort of day to day, and it's a way of disseminating information of what they're doing and how people can help.
The plan is focused on trash, sewage, and sediment, and there are things we can do as part of the solution for each of them.
Currently, initiatives are taking place throughout the city and the harbor on both large and small scales. Whether it's in the communities, in the schools, or in business, one thing is clear, this matters. Earth Week 2012 joined students from the Crossroads School, volunteers, and partners from Biohabitats, Irvine Nature Center, the Aquarium, and the Waterfront Partnership. This provided the opportunity to raise public awareness about Healthy Harbor Initiative.
We're in Baltimore at the Inner Harbor, planting wetlands and pushing them into the Inner Harbor.
50 floating wetlands. They'll comprise 2,000 square feet that will be put over in front of the World Trade Center. And what these floating wetlands do are provide kind of a vessel for plant material that's going in right now behind me with Living Classrooms kids and volunteers. And those plants, the roots of those plants, provide food and nutrition for fish. They provide refuge and shade. Today's event is a way to bring kids and adults and people together to help clean up the harbor. And these wetlands, while they alone will not clean the harbor, they provide a great opportunity once they're put in the World Trade Center to educate millions of people who come down to the harbor every year.
Although the Baltimore Harbor is used for recreational purposes, it is still very much a working port. Ships from all over the world bring in goods to be distributed throughout the country, which is why the health and functionality of the port is important. Several years ago, the port began a revitalization project that focused on Masonville Cove.
Masonville has been a dumping ground for quite a while. In fact, the first time I'm aware that it was used as a dumping ground was when material was brought here, debris, from the Great Baltimore Fire of 1904. That's how long the place had been used as a dumping ground. It was also the site of a shipbuilding company, and many Liberty ships were built here during World War II. So the area has been subjected to an awful lot of environmental insult over the years. It had just about every kind of debris you can think of, including the fact that industrial dumping took place here in many cases. We had old pilings, railroad cross ties, just about everything you can imagine. Here, when we came in to clean this place up and to do a project, and as a result of that, cleaning it up to date has removed about 61,000 tons of trash. The whole area will be cleaned up. By the time we're finished, it's going to take us a few more years. We're just about to open the first phase of the cleanup, and that is the capped area behind us. By the time we're finished, this whole area will be turned from a brownfield into a wildlife habitat and a managed use park, if you will, where people can come in as long as they don't do something harmful to wildlife, and for canoeing and kayaking and other situations like that. It gives the two communities here, and that is Curtis Bay and Brooklyn, the first access that they've had to the water in 70 years.
Innovative minds and organizations continue to try and find ways to clean up the harbor. And one such way is by using algae. That's right, algae, to take nutrients from the water and provide oxygen back in.
A really novel ecotechnology called an algal turf scrubber, which utilizes a structure on land that we pump water out of the harbor onto, and we flow water down a slight incline flowway, and algae grows on the bed of this flowway. And the algae is very good. It grows on its own, its native algae to the harbor. And this is good algae. It grows on this algal bed, and the algae, when the water flows by it, it pulls nutrients, it pulls carbon out of the water column in order to make more algae. Algae is the fastest growing thing on the planet. It grows so fast. And it just wants to make more of itself. And you've got sunlight, you've got nutrients, carbon, phosphorus, and nitrogen in the water, and it will use that to make more algae. And in the process, in taking in carbon and nutrients, it gives off oxygen. Basically, it exhales oxygen into the water column, which is really good for the harbor as well.
So. Clearwater Mills developed the water wheel powered trash interceptor, and what it is a completely renewable energy powered tool for cleaning up stormwater runoff.
So the Baltimore Harbor Waterkeeper is my position, and it's also a program of Blue Water Baltimore. Blue Water Baltimore is a water quality advocacy organization focused on restoring and protecting the water quality in Baltimore. My personal jurisdiction as waterkeeper includes the tidal Patapsco River, which includes the Inner Harbor, the Middle Branch, and as well as the Main Branch Patapsco River, until it opens up into the broader Chesapeake Bay. The waterkeeper's job is really to use law and science to advocate on behalf of the waterway to ensure the public's right to clean water in Baltimore. And as we know, it's a major issue in the city. It needs as many advocates as possible. We have all sorts of issues such as toxics and trash and sewage contamination, obviously nutrient contamination, stormwater issues. And you still see folks in Baltimore still fishing and swimming in the harbor, and it's not safe to be doing that. So we have a lot of work to do, but I'm excited for the challenge, and we have a lot of great resources going forward, a lot of partners that are, including Living Classrooms, that are working towards a common goal. So that's pretty much my job, is to advocate on behalf of the water and on behalf of the community for their right to clean water.
In our school, we have the five promises, and they are commitment to quality, perseverance, no excuses, contribution, honor, and integrity. And it helps me because it lets me know that I can stay committed to high quality work in order to clean up this harbor.
My hope for the future of Baltimore is to one day maybe host the Olympics, like host the Summer Olympics here, and have the swimming events in the harbor, or just to have annual swims or races in the harbor, just to be able to swim in there and whenever I want, just go up, catch a fish, and take it home.
My hopes for the future of the Baltimore is for people to have a heart in cleaning up the harbor and for the harbor to be fishable and swimmable by the year 2020.
My hope for the future of Baltimore is that it will become a better place and more people will visit it, because in the future we'll probably have a clean harbor and more people will come to see it.
It's important to me because I want to have memories of the harbor, not just of its dirty trash. I want to have a spectacular memory of this. Like, one day I could just bring anyone I know out here, just go swim and have a nice time, instead of just saying, oh man, look at this, it's dirty, it's trashy, I don't like this. And I just it's really important to me because it gives responsibility to us as a community, as a surrounding people, as someone that has many different features of contribution.
My hope for the future is that the kids that we're teaching right now really step into leadership roles. If we can get these kids to go home and talk to the communities and talk to their families and have a real rich, deep understanding of what we're doing and what we're trying to accomplish, well then they're gonna be the ones that are gonna hit the ground running as adults. They're not gonna need convincing that we need to clean up the harbor, and they're not gonna need education as to how to actually do it. They'll just be able to implement it right off the bat. So my hope is that the kids we're working with truly become leaders and help us jump that last hurdle towards a fishable, swimmable harbor in the year 2020.